The most awaited tournament at the beginning of 2020, the Gibraltar Masters have finally started. The Gibraltar Masters is a strong international open as it attracts a lot of strong players due to its amazing prize fund. The first round of the tournament ended yesterday, and I have picked a game in which we will see the power of two bishops. The game is Ivan Saric versus John Pigott. Let's get to the game. The game started with the French defense after e4, e6, d4, d5, knight c3, knight f6, bishop g5. Instead of bishop g5, the most commonly played move is e5, knight fd7, f4. White gains a nice space in the center and on the king side, but black tries to create counterplay on the queen side with c5, especially on the d4 square. So in the game, white went for bishop g5, and now there are two ways to play in this position. The one is the dynamic way, which black played in the game with bishop to b4, or a solid approach that is after d into e4, knight into e4, and now either to play knight bd7 or bishop to e7. Both the options are quite solid for black. In the game, black went for the dynamic bishop b4, e5, pinning the f6 knight, and now the only way to remove the pin is to simply play h6. And now again, there are a lot of options for white. He can drop back the bishop to e3, d2 or c1. In the game, white played bishop to c1. Bishop d2 is also possible, but the only drawback of putting the bishop on d2 rather than on c1 is that after bishop into c3, b into c3 and now knight e4, black always has the option of exchanging the e4 knight with the d2 bishop. So in the game, Ivan Saric dropped back the bishop to c1 on its initial square, not allowing black the option of exchanging the e4 knight with his bishop. Black of course went for the logical knight e4 and now queen g4. A nice move. The point is of course that white doesn't allow black to castle immediately here, as castles is simply made by bishop into h6, and white wins on the spot. So instead of castle, suppose black goes for g6, then it immediately weakens the dark squares on the queen side. Though g6 has been played in a few games before, but the weakness on the king side is something to watch out for. Another important point to note here is that black cannot take on c3 immediately, as knight into c3 will be made by queen into g7, when black simply has no way to exploit the discovery on the e1 a5 diagonal, as moving the knight anywhere. For example, if black takes on a2 with knight a2 check, white can simply interpose the c pawn with c3, and as you can see, all the three black pieces are hanging, and black cannot avoid material losses here. So black settled for king f8, keeping his king side intact, though the drawback is of course that he has lost the right to castle. White supports the c3 knight with knight g2. Black goes for c5, a typical break in the center, aiming to create counterplay. a3, hitting the b4 bishop. Now black played h5. A very desirable move in this position for black would have been queen to a5, exploiting the pin on the a3 pawn, as the a1 rook is hanging behind, and putting a lot of pressure on the c3 knight. But in fact, white has a nice resource here. After queen a5, white can take on b4 with a into b4, sacrifice the exchange, queen into a1, and now this is made by the very nice move knight to d5, good move. The point is that after e into d5, here black white can simply take the c8 bishop, which is simply winning for white, and knight c7 is a threat here. Also, queen into e4 is a threat, which simply gives white a clear advantage here. So because of this beautiful move knight d5, black cannot really play queen a5. So black decides to push the white queen from g4 with h5. Now, if white maintains the queen on that diagonal, the h3 c8 diagonal with queen h3, then white can play, then black can play queen f5, because now after a into b4, queen into a1, knight into d5, the knight on e4, as you can see, is not hanging anymore, and black has a very nice chance here to create initiative against the white king now, with knight c6, knight c7, knight into b4, and with more black pieces coming near white's king, the white king will have to watch out, and it can come into danger pretty quickly. So instead of queen h3 in the game, Saric played queen f3 here. Bishop into c3. Now again, queen a5 is a possibility, and there has been some correspondence games here. After queen a5, a into b4, queen into a1, knight into e4, d into e4, queen c3, and white is doing fine. In fact, the position is very messy and pretty unclear at this point. In the game, black simply settled for bishop into c3, knight into c3, exchanging this active e4 knight, which is really giving hopes for black to create counterplay. So white goes for the exchange of the e4 knight, knight c6, knight into e4, d into e4. If black goes for knight d4, first grabbing the pawn and also attacking the queen, it looks quite logical, but in fact it is a mistake, because white can go for queen c3, good move, hitting the c5 pawn. Now d into e4, queen into c5, and after king g8, bishop e3. White has the bishop pair, which is quite strong. The black king is still not so ideally placed, and it still needs some moves to get to safety. Also, white's pawn structure is quite good. His pieces are well placed, so this is clearly better for white here. So black cannot take the d4 pawn immediately with knight d4. Therefore, he plays d into e4, queen into e4, and now it is best for black to go into the endgame with queen into d4, as his king is still awkwardly placed on f8, and maintaining the queens on the board is in fact quite risky for black. So black logically goes for the endgame, and in fact white is forced to exchange queens, otherwise the e5 pawn is falling at the same time. So queen into d4, knight into d4, bishop d3, developing the bishop as well as protecting the c2 square. Now, if you look this position, if you assess this position from a static point of view, white is in fact clearly better already. He has space on the king side, also in the center due to the pawn on e5, and he has the bishop pair as well. This gives him the advantage, but black can exploit the time which he has with c4. Good move. Immediately disturbing the bishop on d3, bishop e4, and now bishop d7. Another nice move. Black simply doesn't waste time, and is in fact threatening bishop c6. Again hitting the e4 bishop when the c2 pawn will be weak. So black tries to neutralize the white's static advantages by immediately going for the exchange of the e4 bishop and eliminating the bishop pair from the board. Bishop e3, bishop c6, and now white went for a very nice exchange sacrifice here. He went for bishop into c6. In fact, when I analyze this game without the engines, I in fact liked this exchange sacrifice. But when I ran the engine, when I analyzed this game with computers, the computers simply did not agree with this exchange sacrifice. They are usually quite materialistic, and they said that this exchange sacrifice in fact gives black a clear edge. But as we'll see, it is simply not so easy, especially over the board. In a practical game, such sacrifices can prove to be very, very dangerous and difficult to handle. So after bishop c6, black should accept the exchange sacrifice with knight c2 check, king d2, knight into rook, bishop into b7, rook b8, bishop goes back to e4. Of course, black cannot take the b2 pawn because of the king c3. Both the b2 rook and the a1 knight are hanging, and black's pieces are completely misplaced. So after bishop e4, black played the logical knight b3, bringing the knight from the corner. King c3. Well, the dust has cleared now, and it is time to assess the situation. Black is exchange up, but white has the two beautiful bishops e4 and e3, covering a lot of squares on the board. Black's queenside pawns are in fact quite weak. The c4 pawn and the a7 pawn both are attacked right now, and they are quite weak. It is extremely difficult for black to manage and defend both the pawns. Also, the king on f8 is in fact not so well placed right now, and it will take one or two moves again to place it on a safe square. White plans to activate his rook from h1 to d1 and then directly to d7 on the 7th rank, or to d6 on the 6th rank. So we can safely say that even though white is an exchange down, he has a lot of compensation for the exchange. Let's see how the game continued from this position. Here, black decided to defend the c4 pawn with knight a5. A better alternative would have been to play a6. And now white should activate his h1 rook to d1. Taking on c4 is not such a good idea, as after king e7, black threatens rook at c8, which is extremely lethal. So after a6, rook d1, king e7, and now rook to d6. White has a lot of compensation here, because both the black's pawns on the queen side are weak, and all white's pieces are coordinated and very well placed. In the game, black defended the c4 pawn with knight a5, but after winning the a7 pawn, which is bishop a7, life becomes quite tough for black, because now the a pawn is passer, and it is actually quite difficult to keep it under cage. Instead of bishop into a7, white could have played the strong move rook d1, activating the only piece which is not playing part in the game right now, and the a7 pawn in fact is not going anywhere. White is simply threatening to infiltrate on the 7th rank with rook d7, when sooner or later white will win the a7 pawn. For example, after g6, creating a square for the king on g7, rook d7, white will win the a7 pawn with rook into a7, and the rook is beautifully placed on the 7th rank and quite active, and it will create a lot of problems for black. So this would have been a better alternative to bishop into a7, which white played in the game, but this is quite logical as well. So bishop into a7, rook b3 check, king c2, rook b5, so covering the c5 square, stopping bishop c5 check here, and also attacking the e5 pawn at the same time. f4, defending the e5 pawn. g6, a4, bishop, rook to b3. And now white played a very nice maneuver here. The bishop on a7 looks well placed on the diagonal, but in fact is doing nothing now after the departure of the black's a pawn. So here he maneuvered the bishop to the strong and beautiful c3 square, that is bishop d4. The idea is to play bishop c3 and remove the blockader of the a pawn, that is the a5 knight, in this position. King g7, bishop c3, so removing the blockader, and so that the path of the a pawn is free. Knight to b7, rook d1, activating the rook. Knight c5, bishop c6, defending the pawn, a4 pawn as well. Rook c8, rook to d6. So you can see how all the white pieces are coordinating quite well, and the plan is very simple for white now, just to push this pawn down to the 8th square. King f8, a5, continuing with the plan. King e7, bishop to f3. So the pawn cannot go any more forward because of knight into a6. The knight is controlling that a6 square. So white drops the c6 bishop back to f3, when again the idea of a6 becomes possible, as the rook will now be supporting the advance of the pawn to a6. f5, a6. It is also important to know that the bishop on f3 is very well placed, covering the a8 square. So black does not have any ideas with rook a8. So frustrated by that, black simply plays knight to e4. But now white simply takes on e4 with bishop e4, fe4. And now white could have even played the pawn to a7 followed by rook a6, which is winning. But he chose a very simple approach here, just not allowing any sort of any counterplay and basically just enjoying the position, as black cannot do anything much. He cannot simply create any counterplay. So king d2, the idea is to go to e3 and grab this pawn on e4. Rook to b5, king e3, rook d5. White of course does not need to exchange the rooks. He simply played rook to b6, rook d7, covering the 7th rank. Bishop d4, rook c7, king into e4, rook c6, rook b7 check, rook c7, rook b4. So white is just waiting and not exchanging rooks. Exchanging rooks will ease black's task. Rook to a8, a7, and the pawn on a7 basically just ties one of the black rooks to the 8th rank, and now white can simply create one more passer with g3, h3, g4 and then f5, when the e pawn will also become passed. So king d7, g3, h3, and white continues with the plan of creating the passed pawn. And after takes, takes f5 and takes everything on f5, the e pawn is passed now and white is simply winning. So I hope you enjoyed this game and learned a lot about the power of double bishops. Tomorrow I will be bringing another instructive game from the second round of Gibraltar Masters. Take care, all the best.